Last time we were talking about dark and light adaptation. You know what do I mean by dark and light adaptation? Adaptation in the dark, when you enter a dark room from a well-lighted area. To start with, you can't see in the beginning, but after a while you start seeing a little bit more and more and more. And this is why in the lighted area the pigment, the rhodopsin and photopsins are bleached, decomposed, تحللوا من كثر الضوء. When you enter a dark area, there is very little amount of this pigment, which means that the sensitivity of the retina is very little. When you enter a dark area, بصير البيجمنت تتحول again, بصير الترانس تتحول لسيس ريتينال and binds to opsin, forming rhodopsin and so on, بصير تزيد البيجمنت. When the pigment is increased, the sensitivity of the retina increases. ماشي, and this is one thing. حكينا إنه كمان this is dark adaptation. Light adaptation بالعكس, when you are in a dark area معناته there is too much pigment. Too much pigment معناته sensitivity is very high. When you go outside there is too much light معناته this will bleach the pigment على السريع. فبيصير الواحد يشوف كأنه ضوء كتير أكتر من اللازم. بعد شوي 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 بيصير يشوف أحسن. This is called light adaptation. Okay, so dark adaptation and light adaptation here is an increase or decrease in the retinal. In dark adaptation there is increase in the retinal sensitivity when you enter a dark. The first part of increase is due to the formation of the pigment of the cones, because we said the cones, their response is four to five times faster than rods. But then the second part, red, is due to the rod pigment reformation. The light adaptation will access sensitivity between ali. When you enter a lighted area, the sensitivity starts to decrease. There is too much light. This first bleaching of the pigment is due to the cones, then bleaching is due to the cones. This is one kind of adaptation. وحكينا السنسيتيفيتي اوف ذا ريتينا از بروبورشنال تو ذا لوغاريتم اوف ذا بيجمنت, زي ما احنا شايفين هون هون. This is a logarithmic scale between sensitivity, and this is the minutes in the dark. The other part for adaptation is to change the hakena, change the pupil size. During the dark, the pupil size increases because very very little light. You want to make the more light enter. And when you go outside, the pupil constrict, what we call it meiosis, and pupil dilation, call it mydriasis. So here the importance of dark and light adaptation. The detection of images on the retina is a function of discrimination between dark and light spots. It is important that the sensor retina adjusted to detect the dark and light spots. Enter the sun from the movie theater, this dark adaptation. Well, light adaptation is when you enter from a dark to a lighted area. Okay. Dark adaptation, this is a gradual increase in photosensitivity when entering a dark. Maximum sensitivity reached by 20 minutes, a little 20 or 30 minutes. Increased amount of visual pigment, this is what this is in. First increase is due to the cones, because the cones there react faster, and the second increase is due to the rods. There is a change in the sensitivity of the retina, around 100,000 fold increase in the light sensitivity. ماشي, the other things is color blindness. شوف, we said that the cones, there are three types of cones, blue cone, green cone and red cone. And this is the visible light. The light we don't see and its wavelength under the blue, we call it ultraviolet, and the light we don't see above the red wavelength, we call it infrared. Since there is three kind of cones, sometimes there is genetic deficiency of one of these cones. Okay, if there is genetic deficiency of green or red, we call it color blindness, and this is usually a genetic recessive genes, which means it is a disease of male and female usually carrier, because it is X-linked, allele X. Since males they have one X, if the X is affected, that person will become blue color blind. If in the female there are two X's, XX, if one X is infected or is deficient, it means that the patient is a carrier. So color vision, the results of activation of three types of cones. The pigment portion of photosensitive retinal is the same, except the protein is different. One that absorbs blue light, the other absorbs green light, the other absorbs as red light, makes each receptor. Any color in between of them, as you see, this is the wavelength of each cone. This is the blue cone, this is the green cone. The blue cone, say, from 400 to 500, 40, 50. Green cone from 440 to 600, 20 or 30, and red cone from 460 or 70 until 680. And just the rods, they have just one wavelength from here. This is what in the rods here you see black and white. So you look any color here, any color in between here. So yellow color, it means there is stimulation of the green cone and red cone in certain percentages. Green color, stimulation of the red cone and blue cone and green cone. This combination is specific for any color. There is no color that has the same combination of stimulation of these three cones. So this is by which this is by this combination we see different colors. Okay, color blindness حكينا إنه it is X-linked recessive trait. Red color blindness we call it protonomes. Green color we call deuteronomes. Blue color blindness is in fact an autosomal trait. It's not X-linked recessive. So this is the color blind. We test for color blind. Blue color blindness is autosomal recessive. We test for this color blind by charts called Ishihara charts, and Ishihara charts, they are put so that there is different spots here. Where here in this case, as you see, this is a normal people read at 74, the abnormal red green read at 21. And you will find around 8% of males are color blind, and here red blind read it 2 and green color read it 4. So they are, this is just example of these charts. The Ishihara charts has a lot of charts to just to examine for color blindness. You see color blind people, they see green and they will tell you this is green if it's just green or red. What they have seen it, they have seen it, they tell you that's green, but when it comes to the cerebral cortex, it is different stimulation than normal people. It stimulates, so if there is no green cone, you look to the charts and here. If there is no green cone here, the chart is different, so there is stimulation of only two or one of these cones, not the other, not the three of them. Okay, So here, the colorblind people, if they look to the red color, because they used to look when they are kids, when they used to see red, their parents, they told them that is red. So whenever they see a red color, they think that this is red. They used to see it red, green, green. The problem is like here, when you mix the green and red color in small spots and put them around different color, it is very hard to pick these green colors, because to pick a green color like here, you need a very sharp vision for cones. So when they're mixer of small spots here of green, and this is where they have difficult time finding the right things. Okay, so this is the color blindness. Now we talk about the neural organization of the retina. You remember when we talked about the retinal layers, the first layer is the cones and rods here. And the cones and rods, they synapse with the bipolar cells. And here there are horizontal cells, which are these are interneurons, inhibitory interneurons. The function of this inhibitory interneuron is for lateral inhibition. They inhibit when the stimulus is here. These horizontal cells, they inhibit laterally here. So here, these, they inhibit lateral area here and lateral area here. So what you have is you have the center here is stimulated, and the lateral parts is inhibited. So these are very important for sharpness of vision, these lateral horizontal cells, okay? So what you have is the light going here, stimulates rods and cones, and you see there is a lot of convergence in the rod circuit and little convergence in the cone circuit. So cone circuit, they have very sharp vision, especially the cones when they are in the macular lutea, where they are of certain shapes. And they have very little convergence from the macular lutea or fovea. Then from the bipolar cells, they synapse with the ganglion cells. There are other cells called amacrine cells, which are also work like inhibitory lateral inhibition for making sharpness. Amacrine cell is different than horizontal cell. They can be stimulated by also different kinds of light. Now, the rods and cones, they respond by having local potential called receptor potential. And you remember receptor potential, rods and cones is hyperpolarizing potential. Also, bipolar cells, they respond by local potential. They don't respond by action. The only cells that respond by action potential are the ganglion cells and some few amacrine cells. So why they do here have local potential to make the sensitivity of the retina even much more than, because action potential does not discriminate, as you remember when we talked about receptors, the receptor area, if you remember from year one, the receptor area is inexcitable, and the receptor area is inexcitable to have to differentiate between different intensities. Okay. So this is again, these are the layers of the retina. This is the rods and cones, horizontal cells. You remember the layers, rho photoreceptors, outer nuclear layer, outer plexiform or autosynaptic, inner nuclear layer, inner plexiform, inner synaptic, and this is the ganglion cell. If you remember the ganglion cell, the axon, they go back as the optic. So transmission of signal in the retina by electrotonic conduction, which is a local action, local potential, allows graded response to have a light intensity. The only cells that have action potential in ganglion, some amacrine cell, they send signal the way to the brain. Horizontal cell, their importance, lateral inhibition, and lateral inhibition makes the center is stimulated, the periphery is inhibited makes too much sharpening of vision. Then prevents the lateral speed of excitation, have an excitatory center, center is on and lateral and surround is off, essential for transmitting contrast borders. This is, if there is excitation here, this is on center, as you see the lateral inhibition here, off surround or on center, off center, on surround, whatever. Lateral inhibition, the function of the retent release is lateral inhibition, okay. We come to the neurophysiology of central neurophysiology of the vision, which is we talk about the pathway for vision here. Our objective to list the stations of the visual pathway, determine the functions of the visual cortices, and describe, you know, the visual cortices from the brain we talked about, or we did not maybe, is the occipital cortex. Describe visual neural processing, explain the abnormality of visual pathways, and outline the importance of light reflexes, direct and consensual light reflex. The visual pathway starts from the optic nerve, the axon of the ganglion cells. They form the optic chiasm. Let's just come to it here. You remember the somatic sensation. The somatic sensation from the right side of the body goes to the left side of the brain, and somatic sensation from the left side of the body go to the right side of the brain. And vision is not an exception, but vision, it means that what we see from our left side, not left retina, what our see from our left side goes to the right side of the brain, and what we see from our right side goes to the left side of the brain. So what you see from your left, right side, see here, say, what you see from right side, say here, here right, it hits the temporal left, and it hits the nasal right. So here the nasal right, and which means that the light coming from the right aspect of here, it has to go to the left cortex. If it has to go to the left cortex, this means that the light that is coming from the nasal, since it is the right, it has to go to the left. It crosses to the other side. The light that goes to the lateral here, it goes directly to the right side, to the left side, I mean. Which means that what crosses is the nasal part of the fibers. The same thing here. A light coming from the left hits the nasal left, and it hits the right temporal. That's why the temporal does not cross. What crosses is the fiber that comes from the same side, from the left side. So that's why, as you see here, the nasal fibers, they cross here. This is the side of crossing, we call it optic chiasm, tasalubul basari, optic chiasm, so the fibers here. And this is the area here. The area here is found above the anterior and above the pituitary, okay, above the pituitary, okay? This is the optic chiasm. So the lateral or peripheral fibers, they don't cross, the nasal fibers, they cross, okay? This is totally different than other sensations. Now here, let's go back and see. Even axons of ganglion cells in the retina, optic chiasm, all fiber from the nasal half of the retina across to the opposite side, joining the opposite. Fibers project to the fibers from the temporal side, they don't cross. And the fibers project to the pretectal area of the superior colliculi. حكينا هون superior colliculi is part of the tectum. All fibers, they go down as tectospinal. The importance of this tectospinal, since they come some light signals that come to the superior colliculus and goes down to move the neck in response to light. So we are from the superior colliculus. And there is other function we come to it. Synapse in the dorsal lateral ganglion geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. So this, as you see, visual sensation, they go to the thalamus, and from the thalamus here, they go to the cortex as the occipital cortex as optic radiation. So here we have the optic nerve, second cranial nerve, and then we have the optic chiasm where the fibers, nasal fibers, cross. After they cross, this they form here, what do we call it? Optic tract. So this is the optic tract. From the optic tract, some fibers they go to the superior colliculi, and some fibers they go also to the part of the thalamus called suprachiasmatic nucleus of the thalamus, hypothalamus. Suprachiasmatic nucleus. Why suprachiasmatic? Suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus, it is important for the circadian rhythm. You know the circadian rhythm from your endocrine. The circadian rhythm, it means that the secretion of hormones is not fixed all through the day. It changes between day and light, day and night, day and night. Or sometimes we call it biological clock. And you remember the biological clock, I said if you travel from a time zone to another time zone, you have what we call a jet lags. It controls the hormonal secretions because of day and night. Is an optic radiation, it goes to the thalamus, lateral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. Remember, basal complex, ventrobasal complex, VBL, VBM, ventrobasterial lateral and ventrobasterial median. Here they go to the lateral geniculate, and from the lateral geniculate, they go to the cortex as optic radiation. Radiation, it has very large areas, okay? And here the fibers, they go from the here to the superior colliculi, and the pretectal nucleus, there is a nucleus called Edinger-Westphal nucleus in the midbrain. This is very important. And from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, fibers from the third cranial oculomotor, they synapse there, and they go to the pupil, the parasympathetic fiber, they go to the pupil, to constrict the pupil so they are stimulated by light coming from the optic nerve. Okay, so here also the same, look here the same as I told you, a little bit of right monocular vision. Here it goes to the right nasal and to the left temporal, and light from the left field of vision goes to the left nasal and right temporal. That's why the temporal they don't cross and the nasal they cross. This is called field of vision. Field of vision, okay? Same thing here, right visual, left visual. This is optic nerve, optic chiasm, optic tract, and this is the lateral geniculate nucleus, and there fibers can go to the suprachiasmatic nucleus, and they go to the superior colliculi in the midbrain. Superior colliculi in the midbrain. The inferior colliculi, they receive information from the auditory tract. So here, as you see, the optic chiasm, it is overlying the pituitary gland. Sometimes a pituitary tumor, the pituitary tumor here might destroy this optic chiasm. For that person, if has optic chiasm damage on, this means that he cannot see from this lateral aspect, and he cannot see from this lateral aspect. What he can see is just in the middle here, what we call it tunnel vision or bitemporal hemi, يعني نص انوبيا. انوبيا. Okay. So this is, as you see the radiation here, the optic radiation is too much. It's very hard to destroy the whole parts of radiation. When they are destroyed, they are destroyed part of it. Okay. Okay. Same thing here. This is left and right. Never forget the image on the retina is inverted. Inverted, and when you see it, primary visual cortex. And the same thing here, the visual cortex, the representation of the retina is proportional to the number of receptors, number of rods and cones. And do you remember the number of cones in the macular retina is too much? That's why the macular luteal fovea centralis, more macular luteal, is represented by very large area in the retina because it has lay very hard. The same principle for any sensory hakena sensory system. The sensory system hakena hunak representation of our body is proportional to the density of receptor. The same thing. The representation of the retina in the occipital cortex is proportional to the number of receptors in the retina. Since the receptor in the retina and the fovea of maculity is more, they are represented by a very large area, okay? So this is, study it carefully. This is the temporal half of the retina. Don't forget when we say visual field or retinal field. Retinal field is different than the visual field. Yeah, retinal, I'm asking, retinal fiber is different than visual field, okay? So here, when there is damage to the part, to the parts of the retina, okay? Damage to the optic nerve here. This will lead to blindness in one eye, called anopsia or blindness in one eye. Damage to the optic chiasm, number two here, optic chiasm. We have bitemporal hemianopsia. Or heteronomous hemianopsia and chiffon, where there is decrease or there is loss of vision in this area, loss of vision bitemporal. What we see is, and this is sometimes called tunnel vision or bitemporal hemianopia or heteronomous hemianopia. Sometimes a mother comes to you with her baby and tell you that, oh, my baby does not see in the lateral aspect of his eyes, he just can see in the center. So in that case, remember that this baby might have a tumor in the pituitary. That's a tumor in the pituitary presses on the optic chiasm, damages the optic chiasm. In this case, that baby cannot see from the lateral. Like, والله ما بشوف إلا بطلعش لأجناب. This is called heteronomous hemianopia. Now, another kind of abnormality when the optic tract is destroyed. When the optic tract is destroyed, he will have homonymous hemianopia. يعني ما بيشوفش بال لما كان مثلا هون لو حكينا this is right optic tract عنده بصير عنده left hemianopsia with side hard with side of the left visual field. Okay. Fourth here, the optic radiation. Again, the optic radiation is too much, so it's very hard to destroy the whole optic radiation. That's why what we can see is quadrinopsia. So if the lower optic radiation are destroyed, we have upper quadrinopsia. If the upper optic radiation is destroyed, we have lower quadrinopsia. It depends. Most of the time, the macular lutea is spared here. Macular luteus. Why macular? Because it is represented by very large area. So it's very hard that the macula is going to be affected in this case. Okay. So this is macular sparing. Quadratic anopsia, quadrinopsia. Quadrinopsia, one quarter of the visual field is lost. Okay. Now here the eye, the optic nerve, شوف هون, this is the optic chiasm. This is the optic chiasm here, as you see, above the pituitary. And then you have lateral unicutin nucleus of the thalamus from the lateral to the visual cortex occipital. This is the primary, and in front of it is the secondary, okay? طيب. كمان هون غير ال superior colluctalized go to the pretectal area. We will see the importance of the pretectal to the dingle visceral nucleus and explaining the light reflex. Okay. So retinal projection, suprachiasmatic nucleus to the hypothalamus is important again for circadian rhythm. Pretectal nucleus dingle is very important for pupillary light reflex, and pupillary light reflex is there is two reflexes, direct reflex and consensual reflex or indirect reflex, and it's important for accommodation because accommodation, it means that when there is light coming through the optic nerve, it goes to the pretectal nucleus, Edinger Westphal, and coming back through the third cranial nerve through the parasympathetic fibers. So the parasympathetic supplies the ciliary body. The ciliary body, if it contracts, again, a contraction of the ciliary body is important for near vision, and relaxation of the ciliary body is important for far vision. Superior curriculi, these are movement of the head in direction to the light. Ventral and dorsal geniculate nucleus control the body's behavioral function. And here, this is the light reflex. So if you flash a light in the right eye, the light will travel through the optic nerve to the right pretectal nucleus, and in the pretectal nucleus or Edinger-Westphal nucleus, there is a crossing from one side. They go to the other side, and then they go to the through the third cranial nerve to the other eye here. Okay, so if you flash a light in the right eye here, fibers coming through the optic nerve to the Edinger, but coming back through the third cranial nerve, and they constrict the pupil in the right eye. This is called direct light reflex. At the same time, because it crosses to the other side from here, it's coming through the third cranial nerve to the other eye, so the other eye also will constrict. This is called consensual reflex. If everything is normal, when you flash a light in the right eye, the right eye pupil constrict and the left eye constrict, although you are flashing the light in one eye. Now, this is important. You are testing the light reflex and consensual reflex to know if there is damage to the right or left optic tract. So imagine that if you flash a light on the right eye and you don't see any constriction of the right eye pupil. Look, but at the same time, you see constriction of the left eye. This means that the left cranial nerve, the right cranial nerve is destroyed. That's why a light goes to the optic, goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, but when it tries to come back to the right through the right oculomotor, it doesn't come to the eye, it is destroyed, but it goes there. Or if the damage in the optic nerve, so if the damage in the optic nerve, right optic nerve, you flash a light at the optic right optic nerve, there is no direct or there is no indirect. There is nothing occurring in the right eye and nothing occurring because there is no light that reaches the pretectal nucleus. Then you go and you flash a light in the right eye. If you flash a light in the right eye, the left eye, the left eye constricts, and the right eye constrict. In that case, you do that. You see that the right optic tract is destroyed. So by this light reflex, and since you are right, you know if there is damage to the right or left optic tract or oculomotor tract. So this is very important. Dorsal, hakena dorsal, it goes to the dorsal lateral mugenaculate, two important function, relay information primary visual and gate control. Gate control of information primary, gate control like it is important for lateral inhibition and it is important for sharpness of vision, okay? So the lateral geniculate nucleus receives input from corticofugal fibers, corticofugal sensory sensation. These are important, yani coming back from the cortex back to the receptor areas for the somatic sensation to increase the sensitivity of the visual system. Here to increase the sensitivity of the somatic system, here to increase the sensitivity of the visual system, originated from the visual cortex. Corticofugal, and these are feedback from the cortex back to the area, input from reticular midbrain, both inputs are inhibitory and contain of transmission signal. Both inhibitory inputs for assembly control the visual input that allow to pass through the cortex, yani horn, gate control, inhibition, and so on. Primary visual cortex located in the occipital lobe of the calcanine fissure. A large representation in the visual cortex for the macula because the macula has very high number of receptors. This is where very important and very high visual acuity. Layered like other cortices, they are lined in columns, the retina, column organization, and each column is specific for each kind of visual sensation. Receives the primary visual input. This is the primary visual cortex in the occipital lobe, and this is the secondary. And you remember the secondary visual cortex is important for explaining or interpreting what you see. Hakena is on darbat if this visual secondary visual cortex is damaged, you will have what we call it word blindness, yani that person cannot explain what he see, word blindness. But is it an the visual cortex the abnormality, you cannot see at all. But if the secondary you can see, and تسأل هذا الشخص, do you see? يقول لك, I see, بشوف. شو اللي بتشوفه؟ يقول لك, والله ما نعرف شو اللي بتشوفه. يعني بقدرش يقرأ. بس بيشوف انه شايف شيء بس ما بيقدرش why because he cannot interpret or he cannot explain or he cannot give a meaning for what he see. So the secondary visual area is destroyed here. If the secondary visual area is destroyed here, secondary visual area is destroyed, you will have what we call it word blindness, okay? The secondary visual association responsible for analyzing the visual information are areas for three-dimensional position, gross form and motion, areas for color analysis also. Processing of visual cortex, separation of the signal from the two eyes is lost in the primary visual cortex. Signals from one eye enters every other column, alternating with signal from other eye, allows the cortex to decipher whether the two signals match. شوف هون زي ما بنشوف انه what you اذا بنتذكر حكينا عن ال requirement for image, حكينا عن ال convergence with divergence. Hakena, the image occurs in retinal fields or retinal fibers in the right and left in areas when they come to the cerebral cortex. They are almost overlapping. Yani what you see, you have two images, one in the right image in the right retina and the other image in the left retina. But when they go to the cerebral cortex, they go to the cerebral cortices so that the signal what you see is just one one picture because the signals, the two signals match each other and they go to one cortex. What you see is one picture. حكينا عن nasal field located in the temporal side of the retina. Temporal field located in the nasal. اللي بيجي من الجناب هون من الجناب هون بكونوا على النيز على النيزل التمبورال، واللي بيجوا من سوري من التمبورال بيجوا من النيزل بيجوا من على التمبورال. انتربشن اوف ذا فيجوال باث في ديفرنت بوينتس حكينا عنهم هدول. فيجوال دي بلايند سبوت لوكيتد بات بين، حكينا البلايند سبوت هي ذا اريا وير ذا اوبتيك نيرف اكزيت فروم the retina, and this is called blind spot because it lacks receptors for vision. No rods or cones, no rods or cones in this area called cone and optic disc exit for points of axon ganglion. Autonomic nerve to the eye. The eye is innervated by both parasympathetic and sympathetic. Again, the parasympathetic comes from the dingo-westphal nucleus through the third cranial nerve. Postganglionic fiber excite the ciliary muscle, sphincter of iris. Again, this is very important for accommodation, if you remember, for near vision, contraction of ciliary muscle. When the ciliary muscle contract, they come medially, they come to the center. If they come to the center, hakena, they lax the suspensory ligament, and then they don't have too much stretch on the lens capsule, so the lens takes a more fatter position. This is called postganglionic fiber excite the ciliary. Sympathetic fiber generate from the intermediolateral horn, superior cervical ganglion. هون ما في اذا بنتذكر اذا بتذكروا بعرفش من نيورو اناتومي في شيء اسمه هورنر سندروم. هورنر سندروم اللي هو destruction of the sympathetic fibers in C81 nuclei. Post ganglion fiber spreads along the carotid. Sorry, مش carotid, carotid here, artery, and eventually innervate the radial fibers of the iris. حكينا sympathetic stimulation, sympathetic causes dilation of the pupils and stimulation of radial muscles, and stimulation of parasympathetic causes constriction of the pupil, stimulation of circular muscle. This is again, this is the pathway for the autonomic pathway. This is the Ellinger-Westphal nucleus. This is maybe picture better than. This is the optic nerve, and we're going to the pretectal nuclei. As you see, in the pretectal nuclei, there is a crossing to both sides from the, say, the right side here. From the right side, it goes to the left side, and from the right side goes to the left side, and from the left side goes to the right side, goes both ways. So that's why again, this is important for what we call it direct. If you flash a light on this eye, because this eye also goes across to the other eye, you see constriction of the right and constriction of the left. Constriction of the left here when you flash a light on the left is called direct, and constriction of the right is called indirect or consensual light reflex. And as I said last time, this is very important to determine if there is damage to the one of the either optic tract or third cranial oculomotor tract. Okay, oculomotor tract. This is the oculomotor tract here. That's coming from the Ellinger-Westphal nucleus back to the ciliary muscles and to the muscles of the iris. Okay. Then control of accommodation results from contraction, relaxation of ciliary muscle regulated by the third cranial nerve. regulated by negative feedback mechanism that automatically, when the light goes back to the cortex, coming corticofugal monken, to control the degree of pupil size. Exactly. Control pupillary diameter meiosis. Remember here, meiosis, writing is different than meiosis, that cell, that's division. Decreasing the pupillary. And midriasis is dilation of the pupillary, the contraction of sympathetic. And meiosis is the contraction of the parasympathetic we just told you about. Pupillary light reflex, again, there are two kinds of reflexes. Direct, you flash a light on the one eye, constriction of the same eye, we call it direct, constriction of the other eye, we call it indirect. Helps the eye adapt external rapidly to changing bright light, excites fiber going to the pre-tectal nucleus, from pre-tectal nucleus. This is explanation of the light reflex, okay? Thank you, and this is the end of the third visual lecture. Thank you very much. Next time, we're going to discuss the other special sensation, which is hearing. Thank you.